guys, it's Kimberly from Keep the Tail Wagging, and I'm here with Amanda of Fluid Motion Agility, and we're going to talk about agility. And I'm like fascinated with agility because I have a border collie mix, and I used to think that he would be fantastic for agility. He's not. he has joint issues, and he's had them since he was a puppy because he runs so hard. He dislodged a bone and an elbow. And back then when I finally got a vet who understood what was going on, he was like, yeah, I hope you don't ever plan on doing agility with him because
he doesn't
have the bones for it. And he doesn't. But I wanted to say, so I was all over your website. And of course, I just find the whole agility thing just absolutely fascinating. I can watch videos of it all the time. My all-time favorite video is the one of the Mastiff that's just...
Yes.
So great. But on your site, you talk about distance handling. And I was wondering if you can explain what is distance handling?
So distance handling is a form. It's a kind of a form within agility where you're asking the dog to do all the equipment, but at a greater distance. So with my dogs, through the novice levels, they might be 15, 20 feet away from me to begin with, and into the harder elite levels, my older dog would get up to 80 to 100 feet away doing all the equipment. Yeah. So the distance handling is just kind of a form within it. It's a skill you can work on within it to see if you can test those obstacle skills at a great distance. Mm-hmm. It's a lot of fun.
And is this something that like certain breeds are more prone to doing well at, or is this, could this be any dog can do something like this?
This can be any dog. You know, most of the time it's the typical breeds that we see in agility, you know, the Shelties excel at it, border collies, Aussies and things like that. But I have a couple of really good friends. A friend of mine runs a Weimaraner that does it. I have a friend who runs a little, cardigan corgi that does agility, you know, big distance work. He actually came to championships multiple times. So did the Weimaraner. So, you know, any breed can do it. And it's awesome seeing all the different breeds, you know, from big to little to be able to do that. Watching the little corgi go 60 feet away is just fantastic.
That is, I mean, it's so amazing because my dogs tend to have an out of sight, out of mind attitude towards me. So if they can't see me, then, you know, game's on. We can do whatever we want to. Even Rodrigo, when he was a puppy, his trainer lived on a farm, but she had donkeys and everything on the farm. And we would train, and then he would have a certain time where he was allowed to roam free on the farm. And I always knew when he was going to do something bad because he would peek around a corner to see where I was. And we would be sitting there, and I was just like, ah, oh, crap. And she was like, yeah, he's about to go eat some horse poop. And it's like, so on your site, you talk about confidence. And that's something that I wanted to work on with my dogs, especially Zoe, who is a very timid, shy dog. And so I was like thinking, nose work or something would be great for her to help build her confidence.
Oh, yeah.
But I wanted to talk to you about, what do you mean by building a dog's confidence, and then why is that important?
So confidence, especially in distance work, is key because the dog has to be able to trust you as a handler, that you're going to direct them, you know, where they need to go, and that they have to have that self-confidence that they really can do all that equipment from, you know, 50, 60 feet away, you know, depending on how far you want your dog to go. So my whole program when I'm training my dogs is it's all built around boosting their confidence. So as soon as I get, you know, little tiny puppies, older dogs, whatever it may be, everything I do for training is basically teaching them they can do things on their own, that they can go out and go and, you know, take that jump, you know, 5 feet away from me when they're little. My little puppy right now is 7 months old. And so he's just learning that he can like go out away from me and go sit on a target mat or, you know, go around a cone or things like that. And so I want him to focus that he can do all that stuff a long ways away from me. So we start close and I just keep building that confidence up that they really can go do those things far away and that he feels okay with himself to go do it. Right. Confidence, I think, in agility is huge, no matter if you want to do distance or not, but it's definitely a huge thing if you want distance handling, because you're asking your dog to go so far out by themselves and they have to make decisions by themselves without you there to help them. So I want them to feel confident about that.
Yeah. And when it comes to people sort of like expecting too much from their dog. I know that with my dogs, I mean, of course, my dogs are, one second, I'm going to ask you to just be quiet because that's just very distracting. It's like chewing on a plastic ball. Yeah, he has the confidence that he can chew that ball. So one question that I have is when it comes to your dog's confidence and expecting too much from your dog, and I read that on your site as well, is that sometimes people expect way too much, maybe way too much too fast. And that's something that my trainer works with me on, is not having unattainable expectations of my dogs. Because since I raise my dogs as pets, you know, there are some things that maybe I'd like my dogs to do, but unless I'm really going to put in the work and the time to get my dogs there, then it's maybe I'm expecting way too much from myself and my dogs. But I was wondering if you could think, if you could talk about expecting too much.
Oh, definitely. And that happens a lot in agility, is that, especially because dogs are so dang smart and they pick things up so fast that you just kind of lose sight of, oh my gosh, my dog's only a year old, you know, and I'm expecting them to do all these great things. And that goes back, for me, it goes back to the confidence thing. If we start pushing the dogs really hard, you know, I want you to do this, that, and the other, and now I'm going to ask you to do it from a distance, that can really kind of, you know, wilt away the confidence. And I tend to make notes. Like, I kind of have like my guidelines of, I want to get to this training spot with my dog, and I don't want to rush that. You know, this should take me 2 months to get to this place, you know, so I'm not trying to push beyond, because to me, it's especially in agility, people like to, they want to get going. They want to trial their dog. They like watching them do all the equipment. And then we start pushing those puppies really hard. It's even harder, like, me with my puppy right now. Like, he's wanting to do all these really cool things, and I kind of have to go, no, no, just wait. Because we get to pushing them too hard, and you can just see the dogs, especially later, they just kind of go, ugh, you know, too much, too fast. And you see them start to crumble a little bit. So that's a huge thing, is keeping yourself in check, that you don't kind of shoot for the moon right off the bat.
And I mean, I know the answer to this is yes, but the dogs really enjoy doing this stuff. They're having a great time, right?
Oh yeah. They love it. They love it.
And how much do you practice? Like, if you have, like, how much of your time is spent practicing? Is it daily and weekly? What do you do? What is your regime?
So it depends a little bit on the dog, depends a little bit on what my goals are with that dog. It is daily. It might not be equipment daily. It could just be doing fitness work. It could be just doing, you know, basic connection exercises. Teaching them tricks even is good. As far as equipment, I try to get to equipment at least twice a week. And during the winter, my dogs always get time off during the winter. So pretty much my big championships is in October. And pretty much right after that, they get from October to about now, is I just give them, there's no trials, there's no intense training. They'll still work a little bit, but it's not intense. When my trialing season picks up, which is going to be around April, then they're probably doing equipment 3 to 4 times a week. They go to the barn and do full courses and work, and then they're trialing on the weekends. So it gets intense from about April to September, somewhere in there. And I give them some, you know, they get a winter off, so they can kind of chill, and I want to chill.
Yeah.
But I try, it is daily. It just might not be equipment daily.
Right.
You know, even like nose work, I'm starting to get into nose work and doing things that are not just agility. So if they're kind of well-rounded, so they don't get, you know, burn out on doing the same thing every day.
And since, I mean, you have like supremely active dogs in agility, what's a typical diet like to maintain that?
So I feed raw. When I'm traveling, a lot of the times, if I can't, you know, motel fridges suck and all that sort of stuff, you know, I'll feed like a dehydrated or freeze dried. But I feel my dogs perform really well on raw, especially using a base mix. I use a lot of Dr. Harvey's base mix. I really love their stuff. So I use a lot of that. But I feel like having that raw diet is crucial, I think, to performance dogs, especially when they are working, like you say, you know, on a really hard week for my dogs. They could be training 3 times a week and then trialing for a 3-day weekend, and they need it. I definitely see a huge difference. I mean, way back when, I was a 100% kibble feeder, and I could see a definite difference between then and now with my dogs performance wise.
And do you add, like, I don't, and I'm just throwing stuff out there, but, you know, like, do you have to add anything to basically, because it seems like your dogs would be so lean. And so do you need to add anything to maybe offset them from losing too much weight, or is it just fine?
So one of my dogs, my girl, basically, if she looks at food, she's fat. So she is an easy keeper. I don't add anything to her. I just kind of like show her the bowl and then we're good. But my boy definitely, he's lean and he does, my husband does tons of sports with him. So he does disc and dock diving and agility. So he gets worked a lot. So I give him a little bit extra fat. So like the other dogs, you know, they'll get, say, chicken thighs, but he's going to get chicken thighs with skin on, sort of thing, where the other dogs, I'm going to take the skin off. Okay. So he gets more fat added into his diet. Whereas my girl, I don't even think about her.
That's so fast. She's good. So finally, is there something that you believed a long time ago that you've completely changed your mind about today?
Yeah, honestly, that diet doesn't make a difference for performance dogs. That was a huge, you know, and years ago, you know, it's just whatever we fed. And I remember when some of like the raw stuff started kind of picking up steam, and I was feeding 100% kibble. And I remember a friend of mine going, oh, well, you know, I'm starting to feed raw, and I'm mixing some ground beef and an egg every day. I'm like, why? It's fine. This is fine. Just give them the brown pellets. It's cool. You know, that's all going to be good. And now, like, that is definitely something I don't, you know, I know there's a lot of people out there that can't feed full raw or can't do anything, but I'm a big believer in, if you are feeding a kibble or anything like that, that even just adding an egg a day can make a huge difference, especially in the performance dogs. I saw a huge difference in my old dog when I finally switched her from kibble into a full homemade diet. And I could see a visible difference within a month of her stamina, her energy, her, you know, and then all the, you know, good stuff, her coat, her teeth, all that. But her performance was increased by changing her diet tenfold.
That is fantastic. Amanda, thank you so much.
Thank you.